John G. Rothfus Jr. I was in the Army Air Force, and I was overseas. I was in the 98th Bomb Group. It was the 15th Air Force and 345th Squadron. I was born in Sachse, Texas on October the 25th, 1924. Before we moved from Sachse when I was 6 years old, that was kind of a community. They raised onions. Not a lot of them, because there's a lot of work to onions, to setting them out and then gathering them. And I worked in the field when I was 6 years old. And then we moved to Carrollton, and I'm older sisters, and I'm sure they made me work the field when I was just a kid. So in the summertime, mostly we were working in the field and school, and we started school. Well, we maybe come home after school and have to work in the field. And when I was, I guess, about 12 or 13 years old, I had to start milking a cow. And you have to get up in the morning early and milk the cow, and then late that afternoon milk it again, You just grab a hold and mash up here, and then when you got the milk trapped up there, and then when you close your fingers, it forces it out. And used to sometimes there'd be an old cat around, and you give it a squirt. We stayed in Carrollton 6 years, and when I was 12 years old, we moved to the Prosper area. Well, I had 10 brothers and sisters, and there was four girls, three boys, and four more girls, and I was the oldest boy. And we were poor, we didn't have anything, there wasn't anything for you to do when you were kids, and so we just did the best we could, and we just had to work on the farm, and you didn't make any money, but we always had plenty of food. We grew most of the food, and we always had good food to eat. And my mother was a good cook, and I can remember, I don't know how she stood it, but we didn't have electricity, and she cook in the kitchen and make biscuits two or three times a day. It'd be 100 degrees, you'd have a kerosene cook stove going. You just can't imagine what it was like, And she was a big woman and had all these kids, and when the girls got old enough to help in the kitchen, well, she'd get disgusted trying to teach them something. She said, "Get out, I can do it better myself." We didn't cause any trouble, because you get a razor strap on your butt. And I know we were all good kids. My brother, just younger than me, my mother told my daddy one time, she said, "John," said, "you're going to have to do something with Bill. He's pretty mischievous." So my daddy would read the Bible every night by kerosene light. And daddy told Billy, I don't know what it was, he'd give him a dime or a quarter or something like that if he'd learned the 23rd Psalm. Well, he thought it would take him a week or two to learn it. The next day, he knew the 23rd Psalm. When we moved to Prosper, I went to school at Ray's Mill. And they had a two-grade school, two-room school, and two teachers. And a teacher and his wife, were teachers. And it'd be six or eight in each class, And so I graduated in 1943.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
You know, I don't really remember much about that, but I remember people saying, you know, well, the war will be over. You know, they knew we'd be in war. The war will be over before I ever have to go, but it wasn't. Well, we went to Mineral Wells, and it was Induction Center, and you did a little bit of training, a little marching, you know. And then they sent me to Wichita Falls for basic training, and we marched in calisthenics and just stayed busy all the time, you know, for, I don't know, 2 or 3 months. And then sent me to, well, I was actually in the Army Air Force, and they sent me to an Army airfield at Laredo, Texas. And that's when we started training to fly, you know, and they taught us how to use guns, and we used 50 caliber machine gun that was on the bombers, and they taught us how to take them apart and put them together, and then we had to learn how to assemble them, put them together blindfolded, you know. But that was really useless, because there wasn't any case you couldn't take a gun out while she's up flying if it malfunctioned, you know. So that was the last of that. But we did fly, and we shot at ground targets and with a machine gun, you know. They had B-24 bombers, and I was back in the tail turret, and we'd shoot at ground targets. And then when that was over, we went to Tucson, Arizona, and the crews were assembled. It was just a group of guys like meeting anybody else, you know. And I remember all of them. The nose gunner was Duckworth. The top turret gunner was McLean. Ball turret gunner was Vogel. And, of course, I was the tail gunner. The radio operator was Schamberg, and the engineer was Smith from Toledo, Ohio. They assembled, I was the tail gunner. There was a guy from Vernon, Texas that was a nose gunner, and he was my really good friend. And I mean, he wound up, he was. But we'd fly missions just every day or two, you'd fly. And we'd practice bombing too, but we didn't have a bombardier. And finally they gave us a bombardier, and he was a guy named Cargman from New York. And so we were going on a bombing mission one day, and us peons, us enlisted men, the privates, I mean, had to load the bombs, and they were little old 100-pound bombs. You know, they didn't have very much explosive in them. We had about a half a dozen loaded, and this bombardier got up in his compartment, was checking switches, and bombs started falling. Well, we took off and started running, and when it was all over, the navigator was standing outside watching us, and he said, "I tell you one thing, Johnny's the fastest one here. When I got ready to run, he was coming back." Well, let me back up. In training, back when they taught you to shoot guns, you know, they taught you how to, if you were shooting at a fighter, of course, if he's coming straight at you, you shot at him. But if he's coming over the side, you had to lead him a little bit or less, you know, or lead him, you know. Well, they taught us to shoot skeet. That's kind of fun, you know. And we'd shoot, they'd have two stations. We'd learn how we'd shoot one, and then finally we'd go to shooting at one, and another would come out, and you'd have to shoot. Yeah. Well, they also had a course there that was probably half a mile around. It was a road, and they had skeet deals all the way around it, and where the skeet came at you in a different direction. You don't have one right on the corner, you'd be turning the corner. And you had to learn how to lead them in all those different things. That was kind of fun. You ride in the back of a pickup truck with an instructor and two guns, and the guy that was doing the shooting, he'd shoot and hand you the gun. You'd have the other one loaded, and you just load the guns, and then come your time, well, he'd load the guns. And that was kind of fun. Well, I flew in a B-24 bomber. That's the only thing I ever flew in, and it had the four turrets and had, I guess it was eight guns, two machine gun in each turret, and it was 10-man crew, and four officers and six enlisted men, and that's all I ever flew in. I'm sure it was the latest. I don't know what model it was, but I'm sure the latest one. And they sometimes, we had two waist guns, one on each side, kind of to back up in front of the tail turret, and they manned the waist guns if we needed to use. You know, of course, we never had fighter opposition. I never fired a gun in all the missions I flew.
Did you ever have fighter escorts?
Yeah, we did all the time. And it was these Tuskegee black pilots flying P-51 Mustangs. I saw one of those guys. It was a fish place in Allen, Texas, and it was a popular place. And this guy one of those pilots come to that restaurant every so many days and brought a bunch of stuff to display. And I went down there. My sister lived in Allen, and we went over there and I visited with him a little bit.
What was that like, talking with him?
Well, it was enjoyable, you know. But we had a lot of anti-aircraft fire. Every target nearly bombed was loaded with guns, and they'd tell you for you. Like, one of the target we bombed three or four times was Vienna, Austria. We were bombing in Austria, and railway yards and bridges. And they'd tell you, when you bomb Vienna, they'd tell you they have 288-millimeter guns and about 100 or so 105-millimeter, which is a bigger gun. And you start over the target, and 2 or 3 miles before you get there, the whole sky would be full of black puffs, shells exploding. And then you had to fly through that, you know.
How many missions did you fly?
Well, I flew 18 total, and the war was over. I wasn't over there about 4 or 5 months. And on the fourth mission, we got an engine shot out. And it, you know, when your engine won't run, you have to turn the propeller blades into the wind to keep the wind from turning it like a windmill. And it, it got the oil pressure and they couldn't feather that prop, so the wind kept turning it and it burnt the engine up. And the engine got to vibrating, the prop and the engine vibrating, and the engine fell off. Well, the pilot says, you know, we were headed back. He said, we make it back on three engines. But it got a gasoline too, so we had to bail out. There was four of us bailed out. And they got too low, we were too low. And I don't know why they waited till we got so low to bail out, and then it wasn't high enough for everybody to bail out, and I don't know that. But we had to cross the Adriatic Sea, and it might have been, we might have started, you know, and the gas got to giving problems, and I don't know that.
So what happened to your other crewmates?
Well, all of them, the other six, were up on the flight deck. And they crashed. They actually landed, but they landed in an olive orchard. It's trees. And it tore up the plane, you know, and finally, also over there, there was lots of brick walls around farms, you know, or places, you know. And when the plane stopped, the nose of it was up against the one of those brick walls, and it was just all underneath part of it was tore up, and the pilot got a head banged up. I don't know what he hit, and the navigator had a leg hurt, but. Nobody else actually was hurt much. And I think you noticed on my deal, I got a Purple Heart. I wasn't hurt. I don't know why they gave us a Purple Heart, but I didn't deserve a Purple Heart. It was after that, you know, and maybe because of going down a foreign country, they might have gave it to us. But, well, it was... We were in Yugoslavia on the way back. We always crossed Yugoslavia, and it wasn't in the war. And when I got on the ground, there was a little old woman and about looked like a 12-year-old boy standing there. And we were right close to a farmhouse, and they took me up there. They grabbed up my parachute and took me up there. And so anyway, we were just sitting there, and of course I couldn't talk to them. But they didn't know my language, and I didn't know theirs. And about 15 minutes, I guess, I bet there was 15 teenage girls showed up. I don't know where in the world they come from, but they showed up there, and the first thing they did was take my parachute and cut those lines off of it. I guess they were going to use the parachute for material for dresses, probably. It's silk, you know. So there went my parachute, but I wouldn't have carried it anyway, you know. But so I stayed there a couple of hours, and they took me down a little old road to another house, and there was an old man that could speak a little English. So then... I sat around there talking to him some, and I don't know, this all happened about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And about, I guess, 5 or 6, they brought in one of the other guys that had bailed out. And later on, before night, the third one, and the fourth one never did show up, but we weren't a few miles from Split, that little town, or maybe 2 or 3 miles from it. And then up in the morning, while they took us down a little road, and we got on a little old boat in a little old river and took us to town and got down there, and the rest of the crew was all in this hotel. It was a British mission over there that rounded up guys like us and got them back to the base. Well, that first guy bailed out, he hadn't shown up. We still hadn't seen him. And we didn't know what happened to him. And we were there. We stayed in this hotel for about 5 days. They didn't have any furniture in it. But we slept on the concrete floor on an army blanket. And they fed us army rations, C rations and K rations. And we did that for 5 days. And actually, there was a piano there, a big upright type piano. And there wasn't anybody in the hotel, but it was right there in the lobby across the front. The pilot and the engineer were both good piano players. So they'd sat down at that piano, both of them start playing at the same time, and people outside would just gang around and listen. And we'd get out and walk around town. Well, anyway, this survival kit that we had, we'd opened them up, and there was $50 American money in each one. And we got to walk in and stores, you know, it was like a downtown area, and they saw some accordions for sale. Well, them playing the piano, they thought they'd like to have accordions, so they took our money and bought 2 accordions. I thought many times, that was back when a dollar would buy anything, and we spent all of our $50 on accordions. So anyway, in about 5 days, they took us out to a little air base, and we flew back to Italy. We did fly on a P-47. That's the only time I flew in anything besides a B-24. And I think one of the questions, did I ever fly before? I'd never flown before I got in service. And we never went into Germany until about our last 2 missions. We flew into Germany and bombed jet airfields. And you know, the German jet fighters, but they were, that was right before the war ended, and they were running out of fuel and didn't have the fuel. And we saw one jet fighter come up behind us over to the side, went way up above us and disappeared. But that's the only fighter I ever saw. And those 2 targets, 2 jet airfields, the first one that we bombed, they told us that you're bombing one that doesn't have any anti-aircraft fire. One of them did and one didn't. And you're going to fly at a lower altitude, like 18,000 feet instead of 26 or 8. Well, we bombed the wrong one, and we were lower, and we like to got our tail shot off. We had about 40 holes in the plane, and we got 1 gas tank shot out. And that scared me more than anything, because that black gasoline made a white vapor trail, and I kept thinking we was going to blow up, you know. But we had to land at emergency air base and get gas before we could get back. We didn't lose many planes. One time, the siren, I didn't fly that day, we didn't fly, and the base siren went off, and we all went outside to see what was happening. And it was 24 coming in, and when it got close to the base, you could see it, and it's one wing, about 5 feet of it, was bent up. Well, it had gone down on top of a B-24 in formation and tore his tail off, and they lost that crew at sea. But one with the wing bent up didn't hurt. Nobody was hurt on it. You know, we didn't really talk about a lot of this stuff when we got back. It was a job and we'd done it. And
So what was your reunion with your family like?
Well, you know, there wasn't any telephones. My folks didn't have a phone. So all this time you're overseas, I wrote them a letter probably two or three a week, and my girlfriend, I wrote her all the time. And so when I got to Dallas, well, when we got back to the States, they sent us to Randolph Field in San Antonio, and we stayed two or three days, and then they let us come home on leave. When I got to Dallas, I called my girlfriend at work and met her, and in the meantime, I think one of my sisters worked at Tachi's in downtown Dallas, and I went down there to see her and walked up in front of her, and she went to cry, and she said, and all the workers around there thought it was her husband, but it was her brother.
Can you tell us how you met your wife?
Well, I met her at the basketball game in Prosper, at a little store across the street from the basketball game. Like I say, I was pretty bashful back in those days.
And do y'all have any children?
Yes, we have one daughter, and she has two daughters. We have five great-grandkids.
What kind of person do you want people to remember you as?
Well, just a good person, you know.
What advice would you want to tell your great-great-great-great-grandchildren?
I don't want to tell them anything. You're smarter than I am. Just be a good person. Go to church and live a good life.